We learned in the Bible that Peter was never in Rome. If our Peter the Apostle wasn't there, was there ever a Peter in Rome? There was, and history tells us all about him. He was Simon the Sorcerer, the man whom the apostles had to rebuke in the book of Acts down at the Samaritan Revival. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery, and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one. And when Simon saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, "Give me also this power, that on whomever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost." The book of Acts was written by Luke in around 62 AD, which was approximately 32 years after the Christian church began. The book of Acts details all the events which greatly affected the Christian church. Now it is interesting that Luke does not write about the other apostles. Where were they and what were they doing? But Luke takes his time to chronicle the acts of this individual soothsayer. Why? Because Luke realizes the importance this man will play in the false religion about to spring forth, and he realized this was the mystery of iniquity which the Apostle Paul warned about. "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. And this same Simon Magus, or Simon the Sorcerer, who was also known as Peter, was an interpreter of the Babylonish mystery religion. And he traveled to Rome, where he developed his counterfeit system of religion. The mystery of iniquity was developed in the intervening years between the time of the apostles and the emergence of Emperor Constantine. So let us take a look at this man who is the true Roman Catholic Church founder. Luke was exposing Simon Magus, and this is a very important point. Luke was clearly showing that Simon was never part of the Christian church, even though by 62 AD many people were being taught that Simon was truly a Christian and the apostle appointed to bring the gospel to the Gentiles. So what does Luke tell us about Simon Magus? First of all, Simon was a Samaritan, not a Jew. Remember that the Bible tells us salvation was of the Jews, not of the Samaritans. Simon Magus greatly used demonic powers to do miracles and wonders. The whole population of Samaria, both great and small, gave heed to him. He was looked on as the greatest prophet of all. Luke is also careful to inform us that Simon had become firmly established in Samaria as the Great One, and he had practiced his powers for a long time. Peter responded, "Thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness, and in the bond of iniquity." Understand, this is a prophecy Peter spoke when he rebuked Simon. Peter knew the mind of this man, and what this man was to become. This is made plain by Sir William Ramsay in his book, Pictures of the Apostolic Church. Peter rebuked him in strong and prophetic terms. The prophecy is concealed in the translation. The Greek means, "Thou art for a gall of bitterness and a fetter of lawlessness." Lang's commentary says, "Peter's words literally mean, I regard you as a man whose influence will be like that of bitter gall or poison and a bond of lawlessness." So what is the gall of bitterness? People today may not realize the exact meaning of such a phrase, but no Jew in the first century had any doubts to its meaning. It was a figure of speech adopted from the Old Testament, which denoted going over to the idols and abominations of the heathen. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verses 16 through 18 says, "For ye know how we have dwelt in the land of Egypt, and how we came through the nations which ye passed by. And ye have seen their abominations and their idols, wood and stone, silver and gold, which were among them. Lest there should be among you man, or woman, or family, or tribe, whose heart turneth away this day from the Lord our God, to go and serve the gods of these nations, lest there should be among you a root that beareth gall and wormwood." When the Apostle Peter applied to Simon Magus the phrase, gall of bitterness, he meant that Simon would be responsible for the introduction of heathen beliefs and idols into Christianity. No wonder Jude later says, speaking about the very men who followed Simon Magus, "For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ." We can be confident that Peter recognized that Satan was going to use Simon Magus as the great protagonist of false Christianity. The later history of Simon Magus shows that Peter's prophecy came true in a most remarkable way. One of the most scholarly of early church historians was Harnack, who wrote an extensive 7-volume work entitled The History of Dogma. This man is recognized as one of the top authorities in the world on this subject. He states, "Long before the appearance of Christianity, combinations of religions had taken place in Syria and Palestine, especially in Samaria, insofar as the Assyrian and Babylonian religious philosophy. Notice he says the Babylonian religion had come especially to Samaria, and why not? The Samaritans were largely Babylonian by race. The Bible tells us in 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 24, that most of the people had been taken to Samaria from Babylon and adjacent areas. Later on, Ezra informs us that others who were mainly a Babylonian stock came to Samaria. These people amalgamated their Babylonian religious beliefs with some of the teachings from the Old Testament. However, they never departed from their own Babylonian Chaldean religious teachings. Simon Magus grew up in a mixed-up society. The Samaritans called themselves the people of the true God, but religiously were practicing Babylonians. Simon himself was a priest of these people. The word Magus is the Chaldean Persian word for priest. Thus we see in the encounter between Peter and Simon Magus, we find a real connection of true Christianity with the Chaldean priest who was prophesied to bring in its false counterpart. Simon Magus, after his rejection by Peter, began to fashion his own so-called Christian church, a church in which he was the head, a church designed to completely overthrow the true Christian church. His idea was to blend together Babylonian teachings with some of the teachings of Christ, and especially to take the name of Christ. And thus he created a universal church with a Babylonian foundation. What is another name for universal? Catholic. Harnack states further that Simon Magus proclaimed a doctrine in which the Jewish faith was strangely and grotesquely mixed with Babylonian myths, together with some Greek additions. This wild syncretism, or the melding of religions, was a universal religion which gained adherence for Simon. With this background, we can understand why Peter so strongly rebuked Simon for his Babylonian ideas. To read all the material that the writers of the 2nd to the 4th centuries wrote about this man and his followers would literally take days. He has been called by many the father of heresy, and apart from the Bible, the amount of literature devoted to him and his activities shows he lived up to that title. With this evidence of Simon's activities after his rejection by Peter, we see why Luke thought it was so important to tell us about this man and proving that he was never an apostle of Christ. In this regard, notice the comment of Hastings' Dictionary of the Apostolic Church. But it need not be supposed that when Simon broke with the Christians, he renounced all he had learned. What Simon did was to bring the Babylonian and Greek religious beliefs into a form of Christianity in order to bring about, as Harnack says, a universal or Catholic religion. We further find in Schaeff's History of the Church, the author or first representative of this baptized heathenism, according to the uniform testimony of Christian antiquity, is Simon Magus, who unquestionably adulterated Christianity with pagan ideas and practices. Simon only used the name of Christianity to bring about his own desired ends. The Dictionary of Religion and Ethics says that Simon was a false messiah who practiced magical arts and subsequently attempted, by the aid and with the sanction of Christianity, to set up a rival universal religion. Justin Martyr, one of Rome's own teachers, said the sect of Simon appeared to have been formidable, for he speaks four times on their founder. He states that he was a Samaritan. He was a formidable magician, and tells that he came to Rome in the days of Claudius Caesar in 45 AD, and he made such an impression by his magical powers that he was honored as a god, a statue being erected to him on the Tiber River with an inscription that reads, "The Holy God Simon." At the time of Claudius, it was illegal to erect a statue to any man as a god or greatly honored person unless the permission of the emperor and the senate had been secured. The statue was still standing in Justin's day in 152 AD, and people were still giving regard to it. The statue of Simon was actually erected is definite, for Justin himself asked the authorities in Rome to destroy it. Later, about the 4th century, a flood of works came out about Peter encountering Simon Magus in Rome and overthrowing him. But these works are clearly fiction. Almost all scholars realize the absurdity of maintaining such a thing. In the first place, it can be shown biblically that Peter the Apostle was never in Rome. So it was not Simon Peter who went to Rome to become apostle to the Gentiles, but Simon Magus. Simon Peter was not the first Pope of Rome, and I made a two-part video establishing this point. The primacy of the Roman Catholic Church depends upon one fundamental doctrine, the claim that Peter was the first bishop of Rome and the founder of the Roman Catholic Church. The fact remains, many authors of the 2nd century, Justin Martyr among them, give information completely negating Peter's supposed Roman bishopric. This is admitted by virtually all scholars. But more important than these, the records of the New Testament absolutely refute the Roman Catholic claim.